It's time to now move on to our next session, Fiction and Fact. I would request our moderator for the session, Ms. Jaya Bhattacharji Rose, to kindly come up on stage. Ms. Jaya is an international publishing consultant, editorial professional, and critic. She has been associated with Indian publishing since the early 1990s. Her responsibilities have included guest editing the special children's and YA literature of the book review and producing the first comprehensive report on the Indian book market for the Publishers Association UK. Her articles, interviews, and book reviews have also appeared in many national and international magazines and dailies. Ms. Jaya shall be moderating the session today. May I now please introduce and invite on stage our first panelist for this session, Mr. Ashwin Sanghi, a renowned writer. His genre is fiction and thriller, and he has delivered three best-selling novels, The Rosabelle Nine, Chanakyan, and The Krishna Key. All his books have been based on historical, theological, and mythological themes. He is one of India's best-selling conspiracy fiction writers and is an author of the new era of retelling Indian history and mythology in a contemporary context. I would like to invite our next panelist, author Ms. Jaishree Misra. Her debut novel, Ancient Promises, became a major bestseller in India. Her excellent work includes books like Accidents Like Love, Marriage, Afterwards, Secrets and Lies, and many more. Next on the panel, we have Ms. Kishwar Desai. Her first novel, Witness the Night, won the Costa Book Award in 2010 for Best First Novel and has been translated into 25 languages. It was also shortlisted for the Authors Club First Novel Award and longlisted for the Man Asian Literary Prize. Her critically acclaimed novel, Origins of Love, was published in June 2012. Ms. Desai also has a biography, Darling Ji, The True Love Story of Nargis and Sunil Dutt, to her credit. Our final panelist, Ms. Sreemoyee, Kundu, an ex-lifestyle writer and PR vice president, the author of Faraway Music, Sita's Curse, and You've Got the Wrong Girl. Also a columnist on sexuality and gender, and the recipient of NDTV L'Oreal Women of the Worth Award in Literature category. Ladies and gentlemen, let's have a big round of applause for this very eminent set of panelists. And let's have a wonderful session now.
Good afternoon, everyone. I hope you can hear me towards the end. Is it clear? Yeah, okay. Well, this is actually a very interesting panel put together. And though our title is Fact and Fiction, etc., we were discussing this a little earlier, and we would actually stick to the brief which was given to us, which is how culture is influenced by literature and vice versa. Because in that sense, then we can co-opt and discuss fact, fiction, the spaces in between, the different formats, what constitutes literature, whether it is only does literature mean only print, does it mean also storytelling using AV, or now what is the buzzword, which is pure digital, and how that's impacting literature as well, as we were discussing earlier, that now authors are also being given briefs like, hey guys, we know you're good, commercially successful, all of that, but reduce your length because it's not acceptable to read beyond a certain length on digital. So that's a great example of how culture influences literature. But before we begin the conversation, one or two things which I would like to talk about the panel is that these really great writers, all of them, without fail, every single one of them is a commercially successful writer. And what is very interesting about them is when you chart their lives through their writing, they actually experiment and explore with issues. It could be, let's say Kishwar, for instance. Life, briefly, with publishing, editor, began to write and tasted success with the first novel, Detective, Strong Woman, Trilogy, etc. and realized that there were so many other stories she was encountering which were bubbling, and she's now engaged in this wonderful oral history program of the Partition Museum. There is Ashwin, again, voracious reader, amazing storyteller, whose manuscripts, you know, he just decided to self-publish initially, correct me if I'm wrong, Ashwin, and then went on to become such a resounding success with his
You're all about storytelling, so
yes.
Spice it up,
exactly. And then there's Jaishree, who began to write, who loves to say that she didn't think of herself as a writer, you know, something like that, you say, and you don't, and continues to write such amazing stuff, and explores things like doing an anthology on motherhood, etc., which would have been unheard of even 10 years ago. Sreemoyee, again, who would today be positioned as a cultural commentator. She, of course, is an agony aunt for The Outlook, has a column there. But apart from that, she's a well-known fiction writer, has had a past, has had a novel which people would term as erotica, fine. But she continues to write. Now her latest novel, her latest book is a collection, is a book?
It's a non-fiction book, which is a collection of interviews with 2,000 single women in India. And everything from, you know, dating to living with parents to not finding a house on rent, even in a city like Bombay. Basically, the reality of being single in India, because I'm single.
So that is a great example, again, of how culture affects literature. Because if I'm not wrong, Sreemoyee, that's actually arose out of the number of stories people were writing into you.
Yeah, what happened, Jaya, after Sita's Curse was, you know, because it was such a path-breaking novel, being a feminist erotica which explored the, you know, forbidden desires of a married and a very low middle class Gujarati housewife. So, you know, I had these women writing to me, just, you know, spewing over with their stories. And because I'm single, I would often, and I'm very active on Facebook and Twitter, as you know, so I would, you know, keep sharing my journey of being single, not finding a house. A gynecologist insulting me, saying that, you know, you're never going to have a child, you're not interested in marriage, now remove your faulty uterus, you know, things like that. And when I would share it, people would just, you know, what I realized is that, you know, today, people are looking for writers who are, in a sense, a conduit for their personal trajectory also. And then I was approached by an agent who said that, Sri, why don't you, you know, take all these experiences, stories of women, and cull it into a book? Because I said, look, the book is not going to be a yo book on being single. Because, you know, you turn 40, I'm turning 40 in December, and everybody's like, wow, you're turning 40. But the truth is, it's a nightmare at many levels also. But nobody talks about it because, you know, we don't want to look at the reality of being single in India. You know, the constant pressure of marriage, astrologers, nosy neighbors, everything. So the book actually arose from voices in and around me.
That's interesting. That's interesting because, Ashwin, you said earlier that, you know, like, Sreemoyee is talking about how culture has actually affected her literature and the way she's writing. In your case, your storytelling has also built upon a lot of the cultural landscape.
Of course.
Isn't it?
Of course. But Jaya, think about it. I mean, that's what we've... I mean, the starting point, for example, in fact, is your name, Jaya. Because it starts with that those 25,000 verses of the Jaya. Which suddenly miraculously become 50,000 verses of the Bharat and suddenly become 100,000 verses of the Mahabharat. So to that extent, we in India have always layered our stories over the years, and over a period of time, we have begun to not distinguish between what was fact and what was fiction. Because it goes back to the C.S. Lewis thought that a myth is a lie that reveals a truth.
Yeah.
So to that extent, everything is the truth. For me, at least, that starting point is a little, very interesting little incident that happened to me in Kolkata when I was there to address a bunch of students at a college. And I had time to kill in the afternoon, so I told the driver, I said, take me to some interesting places. He said, I'll take you to a very fascinating temple. So we went to this temple, and when I walked in, it looked very ordinary. But when I looked a little closer, there was a green-colored throne, And on that was a portrait of Amitabh Bachchan. And for a minute, I had to pinch myself that, you know, am I in some alternative universe? But it was an Amitabh temple. There was a pujari doing aarti. And then when I walked outside, there was a little boy who was selling flowers and agarbattis and the like. And he offered me little prayer books which were known as the Amitabh Chalisa.
Seriously?
I'm not kidding you. This is not my storytelling.
This is fact.
At work. This is fact.
This is fact, not fiction.
So I walked out and I thought to myself, I said, Ashwin, supposing you are knocked down at this minute by a car, a speeding car, and you take rebirth 500 or 1,000 years from now, and the cult of Amitabh worship has really caught on. And now there isn't one temple for Amitabh, there are 10,000 temples or 1 lakh temples. And someone taps you on the shoulder and says, do you think that Amitabh could have been a real man? Now, it sounds ironic to us now, but that is the interplay. That is the interplay which is going on all the time.
Yeah.
Because those are the questions we ask about Ram, Krishna, and so many other great figures. Mm. So it's that interplay is what fascinates me, and that's what really drives my writing.
That's interesting.
Could one hope that one day there'll be an Ashwin Sanghi temple? And then 100 years from now, a dozen Ashwin Sanghi
temples. Bhog chadana padega. Achche se bhog chadana, please.
Do you remember where the temple was? Because I'm from Kolkata, I'm most intrigued.
Yeah, it was on some Sreemoyee Roy, or what is it? Some street called Shri.
There's Sreemoyee. A street.
No, not Sreemoyee. Yeah.
This is fiction then.
No,
yeah,
no, no.
Now
fiction.
We're getting a lot of storytelling.
No, no. Yeah. By the way, I have pictures of myself there.
Okay.
And I must tell you, when I looked at, originally when I looked at that throne and the portrait of Amitabh, I was not pretty certain as to, is this real? Then I looked at a pair of chappals, a pair of shoes that was placed on that
on
particular
that.
Throne. Yeah. And apparently those were shoes that had been used during the shoot of Coolie.
Oh,
I see. Okay.
And apparently this temple came up immediately after that, when his life was saved.
Yeah.
Now, whether that temple still exists today, but this was certainly there 5-7 years from
You were saying something.
Yeah, I think there's always a huge fascination with film stars, you know, in this country.
Of course.
So building temples and creating whole myths around them. And I think my first book, the reason I wrote Darling Ji also, was because, you know, there's always, as you said, the myth and the reality, the fact and the fiction. And Darling Ji was about Nargis and Sunil Dutt. And throughout when I was growing up and so on, there was always the myths that was created that Raj Kapoor was Nargis's real love, you know. And so for me, it was very interesting when I met Sunil Dutt, and he gave me what one might say was an alternate version, that he always called her Mrs. Dutt. He would never address her as Nargis. So apparently Mrs. Dutt and he had this amazing romance, and I was very fascinated by this gentleman who still referred to his wife as Mrs. Dutt, but apparently had a very, very intriguing and long romance with her before they got married. And I think that became the base of Darling Ji. And what was interesting again was to go behind the scenes, to read their diaries, their letters, and then find out that what was being written about them at the same time was very different to what was actually happening in their lives. But just one more point, actually, Jaya, you know, which we just spoke about, was that, you know, for all of us, everyone on this panel at least, things which happen and which remain hidden, hidden from view, because people don't want to actually talk about them. That is possibly one of the reasons why I became an author, because apart from, of course, the fascination with, you know, Bollywood, which I've just spoken about, was my first novel was actually about female feticide,
yeah.
Which is something which I have grown up in Punjab, which is one of the worst sex ratios still does in the country. And I found that there were many families we knew of that had practiced female feticide or knew about it being you know, happening in the neighborhood and so on. But this was like a secret nobody spoke about. So this was the basis for my first novel. And after that, I wrote about something else called, you know, which again is very popular today, surrogacy. At that time, it wasn't. About 3-4 years ago when I wrote my book, again, it was the hidden thing, because I was told how women would go out, they would pretend to be pregnant, so they would actually have, you know, stomachs which you could tie on, you know, of various stages of pregnancy, but actually the child was being born by a surrogate. So there were lots of things which were hidden about the whole practice of surrogacy in this country, because it was a hidden desire to have a child, but you're not able to have a child, and so you go through various make-believe kind of situations. So that was another interesting thing. And third was, of course, gang rape, which again was happening much more than was being reported in the papers. So that was my third novel. But the main thing which I'm doing now, which is on the partition of India, is again a secret that nobody, or maybe the country has developed amnesia about it, because it is 70 years since the partition of India, but we have not ever acknowledged or addressed the fact that 18 million people became homeless overnight. They were forced to leave their homes, leave for a country which was new for them at that point. They became refugees, they often lost loved ones. Many women were raped, they were abducted, lots of things happened. But we have never done what other countries have done. Like, you know, we have the Holocaust Museum, we have the Apartheid Museum. We have so many other memorials to other countries, but in this country, so I thought that as an author, what is it that one can do? So yes, you're right. We started recording the oral histories, but now it has become a whole museum project, which is now coming up in Amritsar.
That's another very interesting point, because there it is, I mean, as Ashwin Sialkot-Saga will testify and your work, but the fact that you decided to create something out of the cultural landscape, and it's still being propelled further and further by creating a literature which is visual, audio, and printed word, as well as a permanent fixture, how it's going to inform the culture further on.
Absolutely.
Because it has literature of this format, in different formats, has arisen out of the culture, but creating something in a fixed, giving it a landscape, giving it a memorial in a way, is ultimately also going to be a constant reminder, which in a way is also going to affect the culture in a different way.
I think understanding of our history. Because, you know, Jay, the other thing is, apart from the oral histories, what we're finding is we are documenting a lot of the material which these people are giving us. So their narratives is actually lending to our understanding of what happened at that time, and we are correlating that with material we're getting out of archives and libraries, you know, here in India and abroad. So there is a whole new sense of what was the cultural divide that was taking place, a forced cultural divide, which actually broke up many institutions within the country, which has impacted us till today, including our literature, our poetry,
exactly.
Everything.
But just one thing. But I was just going to say, taking away from that partition thing, the fact that you're creating a partition museum, I remember going to in Okinawa in Japan, mm-hmm. where there is that museum. And it's there, caught in time. Mm-hmm. And you know, the way it has influenced the Okinawans, and the way it has influenced the thing, and the line of literature, and the kind of oral histories which are coming back, is interesting, because they're not being able to now let go of it, because instead of seeing the museum as being part of the history, as being part of a progress, part of a life, part of history, part of time, it's gone and caught them in it.
Could I jump in there and say that I think it's one of the tragedies of the way in which we preserve our culture in India, is the sheer and complete lack of museums and the neglect of the few which are there. And I'm so pleased to hear about what Kishwar's doing, because if we do not remember our histories, as we all know, you're condemned to repeat it. And we have, apart from the fact, I mean, there's been a lot of criticism that the British never kind of remembered the colonial past that we share with them in the way that we would want them to remember it. They've kind of glorified it to the extent that their new trade laws are coming out under the title Empire II. So there's a kind of glorification and deification of the whole idea of empire in Britain. And we in India are the first to jump up and down saying that's absolutely not right to glorify it. There were so many misdeeds that took place in the name of empire. How can you possibly talk about modern day trade using the same kind of terms. But the fact is, we don't respect our history either. We do very little by way of actually remembering.
What I think you're trying to say is publicly, we don't, because, I mean, as we were discussing earlier, there are initiatives which are happening quietly,
absolutely,
which are not being publicized sufficiently.
And it might fall.
And now we're doing it publicly. It's all out there.
Yes. So that's why it is important what they're doing.
Having said that, one more point I want to make is that when writers, and I think Ashwin will also have some experience with this, because I wrote a fictionalized biography of Rani Lakshmibai and ran into an enormous amount of trouble for the take that, you know, that I took on her story. But when writers decide to do their bit for chronicling or remembering history or trying to record it in some way, I find that the past can be very perilous territory. And I think it's getting worse and worse. I mean, that book was published in 2005. I ran into trouble. And I don't know if I were to publish it today whether I would be in worse trouble or not. But the fact is that it is, I mean, most of us now who would pick up some kind of iconic figure from the past. And I was thinking when Keisha was talking about Sunil Dutt referring to Narges as Mrs. Dutt, he was also conscious of her iconic status maybe to some extent. But we are very careful. I think we're training ourselves to be very careful about how we deal with our icons, for better or for worse.
Jaya, taking on from Kishwar, when we were talking earlier, and she was mentioning how people are coming up to her and sharing their personal trajectories, you know. So I think as writers, it's also, I mean, something that we do is that we are like sponges, you know. We kind of absorb the world around us. And for me, I can say that, you know, Sita's Curse was born out of a woman who wrote to me on Facebook. And she said, you know, you write on women and I would like to meet you. And I had just started Sita's Curse at that time. So I asked my editor that, you know, she could just be anyone. She said, no, why don't you? Because she seems very genuine. And I met her in a South Delhi cafe. And she was a young woman from Jaipur. I unfortunately cannot reveal her identity.
It's okay.
But, she kept her face wrapped up in a dupatta. She was married at the age of 16 to a man who was almost 20 years older, to a Marwari family, very, very conservative. And the husband suffered from erectile dysfunction. So she was paraded to a Guruji who was almost 65 in Indore, who impregnated her. And, you know, when she told me that, I mean, I've been a journalist for almost 15 years, right? So I have, you know, I have listened to a lot of hard stories because I used to also write on women. So when she was telling me that, I mean, I kind of get goose flesh even now. So I said, it just came out of my mouth. I said, apne apne pati ko kyun ne bola? You know, that this was happening to you. Because the first time when he sort of got physical with her, she was literally raped. She was 18 then and he was almost 65. And, if it were a film, then her kind of dupatta just slipped off from her face and she was burnt. Her entire neck down to her breasts were burnt. And she said, "Wo to hamesha bahar baithe hote the." You know, whatever happened to Sita's Curse, the success, the controversy, some people saying that I should not have used the name of Sita in a book like this, because, and the book came out in the year of the Modi election. So it was, the publisher was also a little wary what could happen. But I think I wrote, I constantly felt, and I called her Neeti, this girl, I constantly felt like I had a moral duty towards Neeti. You know, like somehow she had given me her story, like she had entrusted me. And I think a lot of people are doing that with you as well. So even for status single, the shocking stories that I've heard from single women who are urban single women, and especially divorced women, widowed women, women who are single mothers, we keep tom-tomming about IVF. But the kind of prejudices that exist, we say, oh, today it's cool for a single mother to have a passport with just her name. But, the humiliation you face when the passport officer is checking you out and saying, aap to badi khoobsurat hai, sleeveless bhi pehnti hai, ladka nahi mila kya? Small things like this. So I think writers also, we, in our own way, each of us, maybe Ashwin more with history and mythology and, each of us in a different domain, I think we're also trying to push the envelope a little further. Tell a story, a life which was unsung, which nobody, in my case probably because I do a lot of writing on sexuality, sex, gender, you know, it's a lot of taboo things that I deal with. But I think it's our responsibility somewhere, you know, to reflect that in our writing.
Jaishree, would you like to respond to that? Because your writer's journey, in a way, I suspect, sort of would be, you know, from the fiction and all of that, and then the non-fiction anthology that you've written, would somewhat reflect that. Would you like to respond to that?
I always balk at being told by anyone, fellow writer or reader, anyone, that I have a kind of duty or a responsibility or some kind of obligation to society to try and tell certain stories or to take up certain stands. That wasn't the reason for which I started writing. My very first book was just purely autobiographical and was something that needed to sort of emerge. It was something that I had sort of clamped down on for far too long. It was many writers' first attempt at writing, which was semi-autobiographical. So that was how the journey started. But the success of that book kind of propelled me into the rest of my writing career. And then of course, came all this stuff that we've been talking about to some extent, is what are the stories that we should be telling? And obviously, you get pushed to some extent by publishers and editors and agents who kind of have their own ideas or who want you to write it to certain guidelines. But the thing that I always resisted was exactly what Sreemoyee was just talking about, which is that I have some kind of duty to society to tell certain stories. And when I say that, I think I feel very free from that duty because of writers like Sreemoyee, because I know other people are doing that. Other people and some very good journalists are doing that as well, which is telling those stories that absolutely have to be out there, without which we would all be sunk. But for me, as a predominantly fiction writer, my job is just to tell stories. And I don't really mind very much if there's no particular moral angle to what I'm saying. It's just a story thrusting away inside of me that I've got to get out there onto my laptop and then eventually out in the form of a book.
Can I just intervene here? Because I think what Sreemoyee is saying and the journey that I've been through is that the stories are not so much as the people compelling you to write them, but the story itself is compelling.
Yeah. Speaks to you.
There is something within that story. For example, the book on female feticide, I also, like you, met somebody who told me her story, her first words to me were that, you know, I shouldn't even be around to tell you this, because when I was just about, you know, when I was a very little baby, I was given opium and an overdose of opium in order to kill me, which was a very common thing which used to happen in Punjab. And I think that story fascinated me because she was alive. She knew that she had been given the overdose of opium. She knew that her parents shouldn't have done that. So every day when she woke up and sat across the dining table, she didn't see her mother. Probably she saw someone who wanted to kill her.
But you see,
so, you know, that
is,
by itself became a very compelling narrative for me.
And I totally understand that. But the background you both spring from is that of hard, serious journalism. And I think that is what has... You know, that the frustrations that lie within a journalistic life, and there will be journalists here as well, is that you get this wonderful story that you want to sort of tom-nom it and proclaim it to the world, but you're stuck with your deadline, you're stuck with your word count, your editor says, this is too dramatic.
I think a little more. I think we may be frustrated writers who are actually journalists. Who actually want to write and have got stuck with a journalistic job.
Briefly, I was a journalist as well, and I was a broadcast journalist, so my deadlines and word count was even shorter. So I understand that. I understand the thrill and then the disappointment of finding a beautiful story and then not being able to kind of complete it or follow it up or find out what happened next.
You know, I'm feeling so completely frivolous in this gallery.
No, I was going to actually say you're refuting.
I am almost, you know, because I'm like a Big Mac and fries surrounded by Michelin star restaurants.
So, midway.
I mean, so to...
You're the token male on an all-female panel.
He's developing stories, the stories of the richest traditions.
The point is somewhere, for me, I seem to agree with Jaishree. I've never felt any sort of compulsion to tell a particular story. People ask me that, you know, what inspires your stories and where are you coming from? I say, listen, at the end of the day, I'm a storyteller. And all I want is to write stories where people will turn the page. It should be compelling. And I don't have an objective in my mind that, hey, listen, you know, I want... The way I see it is that I have probably, in terms of sense of priorities, probably the first priority is to entertain. Because if I can't entertain you, I will not get you to turn the page. Probably the second priority, but much lower down on the pecking order, is maybe a little element of education. Maybe you might go, oh, I didn't know that. So that's great, if it happens. And then by the time that you put down the book, I'm hoping that maybe you might have that moment of enlightenment where you say, oh, why didn't I think of this subject that way? So if I can do those three things, that is entertain, educate, enlighten, and in that order, then I know that I've done my job. A lot of people ask me, oh, then what about the research? What about the historical stuff and, you know, all of that? What is the so-called formula in terms of developing these sort of stories? I say, listen, it's a very, very simple three-point formula. Step one, your first line should suck the reader in. I call it a Mumbai pothole. So you fall in and you can't get out. So that should be the first para of your book. The last line of every chapter should be a hook, which propels you into the next chapter. And the last paragraph of your book should give a sense of contentment, but most importantly, it should make your reader look out for your next book. So if you can do that, then I think you've got a bestseller on your hands. So it's rather simple in that sense, and that's precisely the reason why I'm feeling like such a misfit.
No,
I'm
not me.
I think Ashwin, we all want to do that. We all want to try.
I think you've covered the whole gamut here.
You
anyway.
Know, Jaya,
India Today has been very
bring
good
up
in
a,
choosing.
You know, slight deviation from this. You know, I write erotica. Okay, so
it's
what
only
happened?
One part of you. I
yeah,
have to
one
say.
Part of me.
It's
yeah.
Not
so
all.
Now the thing is, after Sita's curse, I was really pressurized by publishers to write my next erotica because they said, you know, I mean. Do another erotica. Yeah, successful, so you do the formula. Mm-hmm. And at that point of time, I was actually writing a play, which is my next fiction offering, if I may call it that. And it's in three languages. It's in Marathi, English, and French. And, you know, again, like, you know, inspired by the world around you. So basically, it's the story when I was a journalist in Bombay, there was this very, very famous Marathi theater personality who was found dead on a train from Pune to Bombay. And he had Alzheimer's, so, you know, he kind of got up into, stumbled into the ladies' compartment, and because he was so disoriented by the movement of the train and by people shrieking, and everybody saying, Kaizale, and, you know, like, what is your name, mm-hmm. what is your name also, that he, by mistake, kind of fell onto a woman, and it was inadvertently presumed that he was trying to grope her, so he was beaten to death.
Oh, gosh.
So, you know, there's a lot of erotica in Cut because it's a story of human relationships. It's a book or a play in 10 acts. But, you know, what I also find is, you know, sometimes one is just cornered into doing formulae, which I think is also restrictive, you know. So I was told by certain publishers and most mainstream publishers that this is too bold. So I said, but you want it bold. So they said, no, this is... You know, too bold because it's too real. It's about real people. It's about a husband and a wife. And the, you know, the playwright falling in love with his muse. And, you know, 20 years later, the muse falling in love with a younger Bengali director. So they said it's hitting too close, you know, home. So I also think, you know, somewhere when you're, you know, for me, I find it restrictive because, you know, the kind of erotic writing that I do is not about, you know, goddesses or, you know, like, it's not a 50 Shades of Grey. That's what I'm trying to say.
No, it's not.
Yeah.
It's not.
So I find it very restrictive.
I think I have to say that I've been very lucky in that sense that even when the books have done well, I've always been left free to write whatever I wanted to write, and that has been a freedom that I really, really do appreciate in the world of writing. I know it's rare, but then it's risky because, you know, when you have a formula which is a hit, like everybody wanted me to go back and do another novel of Simran Singh, and I will because she became popular, people came... used to stop me on the road and say, so what is Simran going to do next? Yeah. You know, that kind of thing. So, because she's a detective, she's interested in, you know, other people's lives and goes, you know, like a nosy Parker trying to set things right and has a certain character that appealed to people. Mm. But after that, I went on to write another book on Indian cinema, which I'm trying to finish now, which is again on early Indian cinema. The excitement for me as a writer is to find, as I said, that untold story that no one has told before. And it could be fact, it could be fiction, it could be fiction based on fact or fact based on fiction, whatever. You know, but I think it has to be something new. And that's the excitement for me as a writer.
I don't want to disagree with Kishwar.
No, please.
My friend Kishwar.
This is not. We are not arguing here. We must argue.
But and that's true.
So let's just take a contrary view.
But you know, my agent, I remember this came from my agent first, said to me, "Oh, for heaven's sake," she's an English woman, "there are only 7 stories in the world. And if your name isn't," and I've said my corollary to that was that those have already been told and told brilliantly, and if your name isn't either Homer or Valmiki, then you're sunk. Because they've already told the great big stories about love and loss and adultery and all the erotica that Sreemoyee was talking about, those big dramatic stories, murder, brother killing brother, fratricide, matricide, they've all been done. So we as contemporary writers, the best we can do, and this is what my agent said, was rehash. She said, "You're going to be rehashing all the time, but rehash as well as you bloody can," was what she said. "Just go out there and give it your best shot. Because believe me," she said, "whatever you choose to write about next, it would have been done
before."
Would
you like to respond to that, Ashwin? Because I think absolutely. That's up your street on this
one. No, because in fact, Jaishree reminds me of this a very interesting book by a guy called Christopher Booker, who wrote a book called The 7 Basic Plots.
Yes.
And he researched almost 100,000 odd stories and found that all of them fall into one of those 7 buckets.
But I thought Aristotle had done that already.
Yeah, but Aristotle was too way back. A lot happened after that.
But that
is the reality of what we do. And think about it really, that I can't remember who it was who said that the job of an author is to either make familiar things sound new or new things sound familiar. And that's pretty much what we are doing. It's old wine in new bottles. I mean, and we've done this particularly in this country so often. We have 300 versions of the Ramayana, which tell very, very different stories. I was the other day looking at the various versions, and of course we have what is accepted as the Valmiki Ramayana, where Ram is very much of a human being. And then you have the Tulsi Ramayana, or the Ramcharitmanas, where Ram has become suddenly a god. And then you have works like, let's say, the Adbhut Ramayana, or the Anand Ramayana, or the Jain Ramayana, where the stories take a completely different turn, where, for example, you have the Adbhut Ramayana, in which Sita is the one who ends up manifesting herself as Durga to kill Ravan. Mm. Or you have the Jain Ramayana, in which it is Lakshman who kills Ravan. Mm. And then, of course, you have the Muslim Ramayana, in the Lao Ramayana. And Muslim Ramayana, of course, Ram is a sultan. And you have the Lao Ramayana, in which he is a bodhisattva. So when we can tell that same story so many different ways, then you know we are not doing anything different today.
That's where the skill lies, is how well you can redo it.
Exactly.
No, but I still believe that culturally, there are certain things within a society, no matter how well you tell the story, there will be certain things, since we're talking about culture here, that you will not want to talk about. You know, you have gone further in your erotica than perhaps most women have gone, and said things perhaps which a woman would have dared to say before. But I think that makes your book culturally important to the time that we are in. I'm not saying the rest of us are not unimportant, but things which reveal and talk to a new audience, create a new sense of something different is happening. Mm. You know, I think those books give us more culturally than other books do. Again, I don't know whether that would you would agree with that, because there are formula that we follow. All of us would follow certain formula. But at the same time, if we can unveil some of the things that we are reluctant to talk about, that gives the book a little more value. Would
of course,
you agree?
You have to keep pushing the edge. You have to keep pushing the boundary with every story that you come out with. I completely agree with that. But I think where, at least the way I look at it is that the material is already out there, and it's been said in multiple ways.
Yeah.
What we are frankly doing, I completely agree with Jaishree, is fundamentally making a royal hash out of it.
Okay, on that wonderful note, I'm going to ask, open the floor to questions. If there are any questions from the audience, we have time for about two or three. Yes.
Yeah, yeah, we'll repeat it for you if you
like. Try, maybe they've turned it on now. Okay. The audience won't hear.
So we have been talking about storytelling so far. My question is mostly about writing. So initially, and in the olden days, writing used to be a lot about reading in between the lines. It used to be a lot about metaphors and simile. For example, Tulsidas ki Ramayan, jab Lakshman ne shoot nakha ka naak kaat diya, that did not mean he literally cut her nose. It was actually a metaphor.
Loss of honor.
Without any figures of speech in stories and in languages.
So I'm told that I have a very bong way of writing, which is basically that I'm very over descriptive. These are the criticisms against me, and I don't like conclusions, because in my life I think a lot of things are they are the best experience when they're left unsaid. So there are many, if you've read any of my books, or if you do, then you can make out that there are things which are left very open-ended, with probably a metaphor, or a lot of symbolism is used. And I'm often told that, nobody's going to get it. Because, today who's reading? That's the first question. What are they reading?
So I think what you're saying is the difference that we find between fast food and slow food.
Yeah,
you know, it's the same thing between what you called fast reading and slow reading. So it depends exactly on how much time you have. You might pick up a novel which is written for your cell phone today, which might be like five paragraphs and that's the end of the story. Or you might pick up a Charles Dickens or a Ramayan. It entirely depends on the reader, but those books are being written. It's not like we've all stopped. All of us write long novels. I mean, that was one of the first things which I had to learn.
Absolutely.
Was that you couldn't write a novel which went into 200,000 words, because nobody was going to read it. It's too long. And then you learn the terrible art of cutting it down, and bringing it. So that still exists, but there are different ways in which people are reading. They're reading on their phones, they're reading on their iPads, they're reading. So novels are being tailored for that taste.
Publishers have to recognize that as well. So I think if you're talking about the shift between cultural and popular fiction, or the difference between literary and popular fiction, then you've got right to the heart of what it was that Jaya was saying that we should be talking about today, was how culture shapes what we write. And that is happening, because I think publishers are finding that the money lies with the fast food of fiction or other kinds of writing. So a lot of money is being pumped into that end of the market now. But luckily, because that end of the market is so buoyant, so successful, and the publishers are doing very well out of it, it is creating the money required to bring out the much less read, very fine literary fiction work.
But that, Jaishree, is a classic publishing model which has existed for centuries. Mm. That publishing caters to the age it's living in, and it adjusts itself to publicize and create and publish fiction or literature which is going to be commercially successful in order
to support
the other fiction.
In India, we took a very long time. The publishing sector took a long time to wake up to the fact that commercial fiction was the way to go. We were very snobbish, literary snobbish.
No, there is a cultural reason for that. It's not necessarily, and Kishwar can bear me out on this, it's not necessarily that they were snobbish, and Ashwin, you are the one who should be saying this. In India, we actually have, it's in our genetics, in our DNA, we happily self-publish. We have no qualms about self-publishing and going ahead and doing it. Look at the regional language publishing. Most of it is self-publishing. So it was not a snobbish thing. It was just trying to, I don't deny that.
Can I qualify that though? I think I'm talking very specifically about English language publishing in India.
And which is a very, very, very recent phenomenon. I have seen...
Since Chetan Bhagat, really. That's when it started.
I have seen this industry grow from the cottage industry it was to today, to the diverse stratifications and the layers. I mean, I was writing about it in 1989, 1990. And I have seen it grow. So this comment of being it snobbish is very, as you rightly qualify, only in the English language, because India is actually a market within markets. It has oral history, it has oral traditions, it has folklore, it has the print, it has craft which documents storytelling. It has handicrafts which document storytelling. We have so literature.
And it's very buoyant outside of that world.
So cultural, the culture influencing literature then needs to be qualified as literature. Are we talking only books, commercial fiction, print? Then that's our niche. Or do we talk about literature in different formats? And then how does it affect? Because I have done documentation in handicrafts where I have seen literature change the culture and the culture vice versa. And Ashwin, maybe you can have a comment to say here.
Well, I mean, I do feel that there was a time when English language publishers in this country were more interested in pushing their own foreign authors in India. So to a very great extent, when I went in 2007 to get published, and they would ask, what type of book is it? I said, it's a thriller. They said, a thriller written by a Marwadi man. Oh, wow, that's unique. Sure, it'll do well. I mean, there was that
cynicism.
Total cynicism. And the reality is that at that time, they were really looking for the sort of authors who would win awards. They were not looking for the next Jeffrey Archer or Dan Brown or James Patterson or Robert Ludlum or Frederick Forsyth. They were not looking for that because those were already selling very well in India. I think if you ask me, that change really occurred with Chetan Bhagat, where suddenly that entire space of commercial fiction opened up. And post that, suddenly now commercial fiction began to be treated as the next hot thing, as it were. Because suddenly one was finding that, oh, you know, it's not only Surendra Mohan Pathak who can sell, but it's also, let's say, a Chetan Bhagat
But recognize the fact also it was a timely publication. The fact that the audience that he was speaking to was also coming into its own with disposable income, was joining the workforce, was looking for literature which would reflect itself. So today people like Sreemoyee and you can continue to write in the way that you do, in the way and be accepted for it is.
The question, so though, and I think that's what the questioner was saying, is has that success come to the detriment of literary fiction?
It's not detriment.
Are we going too far in the other direction?
No, because you have to remember publishing and the publishing landscape is more like an ecosystem. You use a biological phrase. Why? Because it is never dull. It's never dead. It always evolves as a response to the factors which exist in the environment. And commercial fiction is just one of the many elements. Its media splash may be commensurate with the kind of importance publishers give it. But having said that, literary fiction, children's literature, which hardly any publisher, any media is willing to give its space, has a 100% growth rate, much more than commercial fiction.
Yeah, in fact, when I went to a bookstore recently, the only people buying books were mums.
Well, that's
another one. Self-improvement.
Jaya, I have a question. I've forgotten her question.
Well, I think we are also running out of time. So if there's one more question, we can take it. Otherwise,
I think there's a gentleman at the back.
Yeah, I can't see you there. There's a question there. Yeah. And that will be the last one because we are already running late in the session.
Hi. So we were talking about museums and we were talking about the Partition Museum. Now, I grew up in Punjab during the worst possible terrorism setup. And I've seen people being shot dead. And it was not pleasant. So now if we start talking about thinking of bringing those memories back, I think those are things we need to forget and stay out of in order to move on. But and especially if you're talking about a partition museum during the current political setup of our country, don't you think it's going to do more bad than good?
Thanks. It's an important question. And yes, we've been asked that question many times before, so I won't say that it's unusual to be asked this. You see, I come from a generation where my parents were, you know, they were born in Lahore. And for them, it was a very painful separation. It was not something that they wanted. It was not a place they wanted to leave. They very often, when they look back, that was a very idyllic kind of existence. Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs, everybody lived together. Their best friends came from different communities and so on. They didn't want to leave that home. But overnight, through no fault of their own, they were told that they had to leave. And my maternal grandfather, for example, he just locked the house, saying he never believed it. He was a lawyer. He said, this is not logical. Nobody can make you just leave your home like that. They left their house with nothing, and they could never go back. So I think this is a story which is shared with, at that time, 18 million Indians. Of course, some of them went to Pakistan. Some of them came to India. Some of them lost family members and so on. And so, but it was a very, very horrible tragedy that took place. The reason we worry that are we going to, if by repeating it, are we kind of going to make it happen again? No, because if you come to our museum, you'll see that in the narrative, the way we have told the story, the last story, the last gallery is the gallery of hope, where when people come, they see very positive stories about communities living together, how they helped each other even in those days and continue to do so. So I think it is also the narrative that we need to tell. It is a real narrative because it comes from libraries, from archives, from people's oral histories, from things that they remember. But by forgetting it, I think we're doing ourselves a great injustice.
Okay.
Because if we forget it, then we will be condemned to repeat it again.
But Kishwar, thank you so much for that, because I like the way you ended, you structured the museum and said we end with a point of hope. Yeah. Because that is what all storytellers do. Whether they're reporting the negative or the positive or whatever, there is always hope. And that's one of the first things we tell children in our stories is, however dark the story is, there is hope. So thank you very much. And thank you, everyone, for a lovely discussion.
Thanks, Jaya. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I want to thank all our panelists and especially our moderator for this very, very wonderful session, session full of stories. May I please invite Ms. Shivani Malik, Director Marketing DA Milano, to please come up and present a token of appreciation to our panel. Thank you very much once again.